Charles. It's good to see you, Brother Friday. It's good to see all of you. It's good to see you, Brother Jerry. Good to see you, Brother Andrew. Good to see you, Sister Lily. Good to see you, Sister Khadija, and Sister Alte, and Sister Patsy, and Sister Alicia, and Sister Alma, and Anaya, and Zaria, and Sister Shivon, and Sister Will, and Sister Keisha, Sister Agatha, and Brother Jacob. And of course, Queen of Worship, it's good to be here. Malik is the family of Jeff. It's good to be alive this morning. But I mean, it's good to see. We really thank God that we are alive. Because when we are alive, things can happen. When we are alive, we can, you know, in the grave, who shall give God thanks? In the grave, none shall give God thanks. You give God thanks when you are on this side. And so we are here, we give God thanks and praise. So let's just get an attitude and an attitude. You know, the atmosphere is already here, so let's just get an attitude and give God praise. Let us just get some attitude to give God praise as we celebrate the month of December, we celebrate this time of the year. We have had 11 months before this one, final month of the year. It's good to be alive, it's good to be alive. We say good morning to all those who have joined us on Zoom and who are alive and who are there with us. We bless you and we thank you for following on us since April, following us throughout, and we give God thanks to you, we give God praise. What can we just stand and go to God in prayer? Can we just stand and go to God in prayer? Bless your name, Father, we give you thanks. Oh, this morning we have assembled with God, not because of us, God, we have assembled because of you, oh God. We have assembled to give you honor and to give you glory, God. Father, you have been good to us, and Lord, we just thought it fit to come back in your house collectively and to bless your name, God, to give you honor, to give you glory, God, to magnify you, to thank you, God. Father, we have come, God, to join our voices together, God, to give you praise. We have come to join our hearts in appreciating you. We have come to join our voices in testifying of your goodness. Father, we are alive and we know, God, it's because of you, God. For when we check and we come, God, the things we did, God, it was not always right and correct in your sight. Yet, God, you forgive us. Yet, God, you pardon us. Yet, you favor us, God, and you brought us back here another time, God, where we can repent, where we can ask you to forgive us, God, where we can ask you to cleanse us, where we are weak, we ask you to strengthen us, God, so that we can give you what you deserve. And you deserve the honor, God. You deserve the glory. You deserve the praises, God. And we have come in this place, God, to give you praise, God. We will worship you, God. We will bless your name. We will magnify your name, God. We will lift up our hands and glorify you, God, because you are the true and the living God. We serve no other God. There is none like you. There is no other God. When we were done, God, it is you, God, who lifted us up, God. Lord, when we needed comfort, God, it was your arms, God, that enclosed us, oh God. You kept us right here, God. Lord, when we were alone, God, it was you who came and said, I will be with you, God. And so we come this morning to appreciate you for what you have done, God. And Lord, we know, God, there are so many other things to do for us, God. So we come, God, not for things that you have already done, God, but for things that you are to do yet for us, God. And in faith, God, we believe. And we know, God, we know, God, we know, God, your young people cry out, God. Some cry out for jobs, God. Some cry for security of one kind or the other. Some cry for so many different things. But here is a place, God, where we can come to you and we can agree, God, and every one of our young person in our young people, God, you will bless, God. You will favor, God. You will keep, God. You will provide, God. You will sustain, God. You will keep them safe, God. The older ones, God, you will bless, God. You will minister to them, God. The children, God, you're going to continue to protect, God. All of us in your presence, God, you're going to just watch over us, God. We say, thank you, God. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. What a mighty God we serve. Father, we serve you because you are a mighty God. We serve you because you are King of Kings and you are Lord of Lords. We serve you, God, because you have not failed, God, and you will not fail, God. We serve you, God, because you have proved yourself over and over again to us, God. We serve you, God, because you are the true and the living God. And we serve you as the King of Life, God. This morning in your presence, God, we lift up our pastor before you, God. And we lift up Pastor Pascal before you. We say thank you, God. Thank you for providing us, God, with a man, God, who loves you, God. With a man who loves your word, God. With a man who
want to teach your people, God. We lift him up this morning. We surround him. He seeks the very presence, God, with your angels, God, who you have assigned over him, God. In the name of Jesus, you continue to watch over him. Continue to watch over his health, God. Continue to watch over his home, God. His wife and children and grandchildren and daughter-in-law. We lift them all up to you, oh God. This morning, we just bless the family, God. In the name of Jesus, we pronounce blessings, God. We pronounce favor, God. Father, for every one of us again, God. Each one in your presence this morning, just for getting up, God, and being in your presence, God. Just for coming out, God, to worship you. God, just to have a heart, God, to be in your presence. Bless us, God. Bless us, God. Lord, the opportunity is here for us to praise you. The opportunity is here because life is a time to make our peace calling and our election sure. We have life in our bodies. This morning, God, we are going to praise you. We're going to bless you, God. We're going to rejoice when we hear your word. We're going to thank you for that word that will be deposited into our spirits for the week to come, God. We give you praise. Those on the way, God, bless them all the same. Those who listen to us electronically, God, bless them as well, God. And in the end, God, all honor and all glory will come right back to you, for you are God. We thank you in Jesus' almighty name.
Amen.
In Jesus' almighty name.
Amen.
Oh, we give God praise. People, I don't know for you, but I do not take life for granted anymore because I realize it has nothing to do with age. It has nothing to do with size. It has nothing to do with height or breadth. It all has to do with the goodness and the favor of God. And God has so seen it fit to keep us alive. Because there are better people than us who are living better lives than us who may have passed on during the week. It is not because we have been so good to God that he kept us. It is God's favor. Friends, you see, favor is that which comes. Even though you deserve it, God says, I will give you favor. Nobody can take that from you. And the favor of God is upon me and you.
I don't know why I say that, but let me
the favor of God. Let the devil know that the favor of God is upon you. We are here this morning because God's favor is upon us. It doesn't matter what you did. It doesn't matter where you were. It doesn't matter how good or bad you have been. God's favor is upon us.
bless the Lord. We are here to appreciate the fact that God has kept us. We are here to appreciate the God who has kept us. And we give you an opportunity. There may be somebody here you want to testify. And if you have a testimony, if you have a testimony and you wish to share it, we give you an opportunity. Now, anybody want to testify of the goodness? Testify of the goodness of God. Want you to come and testify of the goodness of God? Let's come take this microphone and testify. No, we need you to come because posting on Zoom keep saying that they don't see and hear those and they want to be part of it. So come and share it from here, please. Somebody else this morning, you have a testimony, come with your testimony, we give God praise. Come on people, we give God praise. We give God praise. For he's a good God. He's a mighty God. Yes, who we have missed for a little while. And we, from all indications, is according to Pastor Shedrick, he looks more than he's alive.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
I'm in a place this morning I'm supposed to be.
Amen.
And I give God all the praise, all the thanks, and thank Him for bringing me out this morning. You know, I don't know where people get this thing from, that old age is an honor. But it's not an honor when you have pain and you can't move as a boat, you know. Right? Old age is an honor when you could move around, you're healthy and everything. Pastor James Berry always have that word, he always say that if you don't want to die young, you will get old. And getting old has consequences. So I want to thank God for this morning I'm here. And all those who was praying for me, and I've said God to give me the best of health. So I want to thank everybody. And Brother Leroy, thank you. I know you are concerned, you're always asking about me. But God is good. And His mercy is enduring forever.
Amen. 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 I hear Brother Henry say you old. Brother Henry was telling me you old. And I want to say to Brother Henry, tell Brother Keith, you know when you're ready to come back, all of us coming in the airport with Brother Friday, you're able to come because he'll be old by that time. But from all indications, he's looking good. You know, David, the psalmist says in Psalm 37, verse 25, I was young and then I'm old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. Friend, there are going to be time when those who are young will recognize that they are too old. But you know what? Never forsake God. Only make it right with God. Only be in the presence of God. Be there. Because that same psalm, if you start and you look at that entire psalm, that psalm is ready for Christian people who are under pressure. You know? Because they say, fret not at the evildoers. Fret not because this and that. Fret not because they will last. They will last a little while. But you wait and watch. God is going to come. Come in, and he's going to make sure at the end of the day, he will not forsake you. Things are going to go up, down, and across, but God is going to come and be your deliverer. And that is what the psalmist was saying. I was young, I was old, but I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread. You will not go hungry. You will not go comfortless. God will always be with you. Somebody wants to take this mic and testify. Sister Galen, I see you on there. You're trying all out, you're spinning out. Come and take the mic and testify. You know God is good. I see you spinning around. I see you keep putting out your hand and putting it right over. Come take it from here. God is good. God is good. Friends, God is good. God is good. God is good. God is good.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Brothers and sisters. I have to thank God for being here also this morning. And for what He have done for me.
Amen.
You know, because normally when they see water by that pump, it's trouble. But I thank God, the trouble come or the trouble pass.
Amen.
The trouble that. All that tell God, I said, not able with this thing again. I'm getting home now. I ain't able to clean up this thing at home again. Maybe for just in a little crack, where some water come through. And you won't believe when you see where that water come through. I can tell you water is a very dangerous thing. You understand? And I thank God that everybody come, my family and they come and who come across the desk, come across and just give a little help because it was nothing much to do. So I thank God, it was 94.
Yes.
You understand? I always have to thank God that it was better, plenty better than before. So I thank God for that. And I thank God for life. No, I'm suffering a little bit of pain and then so there's all the things on for the treatment.
All these people who used to boast how young they are, how young they look, and how young they could do. All of us would just start to talk about age. Yeah? Come on, I don't know for you young people, review that in the name of Jesus. You know, review that. We young. Come on, somebody else, you want to testify of God's goodness? Come testify of God's goodness. God has been good to you, and you know God has been good to you. You know God has been good to you. You do not sit and know that God has been good and not say God is good. Because friends, when you go through trials and ups and downs, it's God you go to, you know? It is God you go to. And when God deliver you, you should come back and testify. That chorus that you sing, where are the nine, where are the nine? One man come to worship, one man come to sit down. Let it be you who came back to give God down. Somebody else this morning, you just want to testify of God's goodness. Come on, we have 90 minutes, you know?
Good morning, church. Well, thank God for this continued provision. Last Sunday, I took a lot of Sissy, keep the church, Mr. Sissy money in the hand, get the envelope, put the money, not knowing that I dropped 100. And I want to thank God that 100 was four. And I could have put my sister for this good, thanks to good church members that have worked with us. And now I'm talking to him, no, even we have been open 3 days a week and this week I'm calling and this morning people are praise. He makes a way something I don't see.
Yes.
But he makes a way, I'm thankful for his continued mercy and grace towards me. He's an awesome God. I'm thankful for youth, because these young people who complain, so I'm thankful for health and strength, good movement.
Yeah, man, thank God for youth. According to the social, it won't always be like this. But we give God thanks, And friends, whoever it is, who from them or another one, they will die for this. You know, some people have this thing, you know. Oh, God blind everybody eyes in me alone to see it. That's a lie. You don't have to catch it at all. You know it's not yours, even to who it belongs to. God has blind your eye at all. God has blind the rest of people's eyes so that they can't see it. It's not yours. And we give God thanks, as he said, and for company, you see something that you don't know that is not yours, give it to somebody new. You know, come on, stand up. Because anybody wants to testify again? Anybody else want to testify? Okay, come to Alicia. Jesus. Father, for the week ahead, we pray a special blessing, God. A blessing that she will come back here, God, and testify of your goodness. We speak it, God. We speak and we agree that Alicia will receive a special blessing for all that she's doing in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. And we'll continue to pray for Alicia. Friends, let me tell you something. It's not easy. Remain standing. Remain standing. This week one day I spoke with Alicia was going to be there. Alicia, but somebody came up. Oh, come, brother. This is Brother Jerry. We got the Jerry who opened this testimony.
Good morning, Jerry.
Good morning.
I'm just a young doctor. I went to Africa, said, we were having some tests. But good. I went again and it's a good test. Where it was, because it's a little time. It used again. So then, thank God for him. Healing.
Amen. Let the Lord continue healing up, brother. You know, this week Pastor Don has spoken, brother Don and Glenn Galop. Don spoke from Edge of Samson and straight up to Belloman. You know, Dr. Talk in medical talk. He did, of course, extend all his blessings for the church and stuff. And you know, he has blessed his daughter, you know, because friends, sometimes you have to turn the eyes. You have to turn the eyes because man will not always give you encouragement. Encouragement comes from God. Sometimes when you're looking in quarters, you're looking for it to come, it may not come. But you know what? We thank God. You know, as we said in Psalm 27, verse 25, I was young and no old, I've never seen the righteous forsaken. You just do it right with God. You continue to stay right with God, and you will not be forsaken. Just as you said, you just continue, keep on keeping on. You continue to do what you're doing. Your blessings is already sure. The blessing that God has for you, it is already written. And that is yours. And that is yours. We serve our mighty God this morning. We serve our holy, holy, holy God, God Almighty. It's a privilege. It's a privilege to serve that God. It is a privilege. It's an honor to serve that God. For He's King of Kings, Lord of Lords.
It's a pleasure to stand.
don't feel as though he is great, because sometimes the situation comes and it overwhelms you. The situation can overwhelm you, and you know, you can feel, you know. And as that song that we sing over and over, sometimes the floods, the water comes so much that you feel as though you're drowning. You know, just Friday night, you know. There was a situation not too far off. Well, I understand for me, and somebody started to call me, but to be honest, I came home late. I was running short and had on pajamas. So when Joy told me, so and so said, oh, come now. I didn't have the strength. I couldn't have read it. The next day, when I heard all the dramas and everything, I was like, but the thing about it, there comes a time when man will not be there, you know. There comes a time when you would send the call, man, and man will not be there. But friends, you see, God will not forsake you. God will not leave you alone. God will always be at your side. There comes a time when man, when mother and father may not be there. There comes a time when all around will not be there. There comes a time when the police will not be there. But you know what? The God you serve, he will always be with you. He said he is not going to leave you. He is not going to forsake you. And once he is with you, that is all right. And that moves me to sing just in this song, from be close to you. Because friends, sometimes you want to be so close to God, and you need to let God know. God, I want you to know, I want you to know that you need to let me know that you are near. Because sometimes you feel that no, God is so far away. And brother, you feel as though he's so distant. You feel as though this situation you're going through, it's just you and you alone. And where is God? And you just need to say, God, I want to know that you are here. I want to know that you are here. I want to know that you are right here with me. I want to know. You know, there's a song said that if you're not in here, if your presence is not here, I ain't want to be here. I ain't going if your presence is not going with me. I'm not going. But if you're not here, there's no sense to me to be here. So you say, God, come close to me. I want to know. Help me know. Help me know that you are here. Help me know. You don't feel like that sometimes. And you don't feel as though God has forsaken you. All that I say is ask God to draw us near, to draw us close to him.
Draw me close to you.
Sister Frances can't move as we as she used to move. And as you wish you could be in God's
house.
To lift a hand and to sing up
really.
I can speak of my own mother, who is on a bed and cannot move on her own more than a year. And somebody who was always in the presence of God, who always wanted to dance to the Lord, and who always wanted to be here to the Lord. You could imagine how these people feel. You understand where I'm coming from? You understand the appreciation for this life that we have? You understand the appreciation we should have for this freedom that we have? Being able to move our hands and our feet, being able to be alive and to come to talk and to walk. If Duncan have walked, Duncan have walked out of the hospital. If Duncan have moved out of the hospital, he did not want to be, he never wanted to be there. He never told him, he took up residence there because he liked being there. When he spoke to him this week, he said, I'll be out soon. He has been saying that for a while. Praying soon for somebody who can't move, could be 10 years. But soon for you could be next 2 minutes. Because you can tell somebody a couple of you can get up here and leave and you can go and meet them because you have that freedom. Some people don't have that. Friends, stop taking this life for granted. Stop taking this time for granted. Stop taking this fresh air for granted. We look at the news during the week. One 18-year-old went to the grandmother's wedding party. Next thing, they found her naked somewhere. And you 18-year-old sometimes feel that you have life in your hand and you can do what you want when you can't do it. It is snuffed out just like that. A young lady who came to church here, and she came to church many times before. That is my sister Mary. She worked at the open sister Pearl. She was like my house yesterday to conduct some business. And she was saying, Brother Desley, my brother and my nephew were killed the other day. And only to realize her nephew was the one they had driving up and down alive on a van, driving up and down. That's her brother's son. And I'm still looking here, I just have to tell you. And I'm saying we take things for granted. Father and son was killed together, remember?
Yes.
And you young men feel you have life in your hand. So I can do what I want, when I want, and how I want. And you don't realize that you don't have to be in a bandit shop for them to shoot you. You don't have to be in a place where only gangsters are to be snuffed out. Friends, stop taking this time and this life for granted. Let us acknowledge. Let us acknowledge. The psalmist said, I was young, I was old, and never seen the righteous. You get what he said? I've never seen the righteous. None of us are perfect, but friends, every day we should make it right with God. And that makes us righteous. Because we're making it right with God every day. We are not perfect, so we're going to make mistakes. But every opportunity you have, make it right with God. I don't know if there's anybody here this morning. I want to make it right with God. I don't know if anybody else wants to make it right with God. We're going to invite you to come. Come, let us make it right with God. Let us make it right with God. Not because you have sin and sin, not the place, you know. But you want to make sure, according to the psalmist, I don't want God to forsake me. He says, I was young, I was old. I've never seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed bread and bread. I want to make it right with God so that God will never forsake me and he's always my provider. Let us stop taking it for granted. Anybody want to make it right with God? We're going to sing that song again. Draw me closer.
Together, say that I am your friend.
that you are where God wants you to be. And we give you thanks and praise to these who have come and fall ourselves, God. We give you thanks, God. God, we thank you that in your presence, God, and in your presence we can make our peace calling and our election. So we ask you for your cleansing right now, God. For these who stand, God, we know, God, as best as we try sometimes, God, Lord, for the good we know we need to do. Like Paul said, God, that which we know we need to do sometimes, it finds itself so difficult. But God, this morning, God, we rely upon you for strength, God. We pray for fresh strength upon our lives, God, in the name of Jesus. As they stand before you, God, Lord, this is an act of faith, God. In Christ, I can do it. For the rest of that is, God, without you, they cannot do it. But with you, oh God, all things are possible. And we say thank you, God, for the possibility of being a victor, the possibility of being victorious, the possibility of doing it right, God. Father, we ask, God, that they will make it right with you. You will make it right with them. God, their very needs will be met. God, you will continue to cover them. You continue to supply. Father God, you bless and you bless and you bless in the name of Jesus, God, for every need, for all that is standing in need of, God, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, the true and the living God, the God who has been able, the God who has done it before, do it for them, God, do it for them this morning, God, in the name of Jesus. We say thank you, God, for that there are those who are not here, God, but they may be saying, oh God, they want to make it right, God, wherever they are, in the name of Jesus, God, we lift them up before you, God, we think of all those around, God, in the name of Jesus. And we say thank you, God. We bless you, God. We give you praise in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you.
Hallelujah. So we call out hallelujah to God. We are so unworthy, God. But in spite of who we are, you called us, God. In spite of who we are, you chose us, God. And we say thank you. Thank you, God, that we can be in your presence. Thank you that we can experience, God, something of this moment, God. Something of this matchless, God, that you are. We say thank you, God. I cannot minister to your people. It is you who will do that. I just pray this morning that you will just use me as your instrument so that the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts will be acceptable in my sight. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. And amen. You can have a seat. Hallelujah. God, it's good to be in the presence of God again.
Amen.
That's good. Our theme for 2020 as a church continues to be God's great expectations. Our quarterly theme is God expects obedience and commitment. The first half of the quarter, we spoke about God's expectation of obedience. We did say for the latter half of the quarter, we will be speaking about God's expectation of commitment from his people. Our quarterly theme scripture as it relates to commitment is taken from 1 Kings chapter 8, verse 16, which says, "And may your hearts be fully committed to the Lord our God, to live by his decrees and obey his commands. As at this time, my topic this morning for me as long as absolutely necessary, it's God's commitment to comfort. God's commitment to comfort. And the passage of scripture I want to make reference to is taken from John 14, verses 1 to 3. But I don't want to read it as it. I just want you to can find it in the Bible more long ago. Then I say good morning to everyone. Good morning to all of you and to our viewers, to those who are with us via the social media. We welcome you this morning. This being the last first Sunday in the year 2020. Good to have reached this place when we started off the year, the first Sunday in this year, we didn't. None of us could have written it down and said for sure that we would be here this last Sunday. There are a lot of people who we knew who were here in January, the first Sunday in January, and they are not here this first Sunday in December. Like Leon said in his leading this morning, we do not take that privilege for granted. It's not because of any good thing that we have done, but it's because of the love and kindness of Almighty God. And we acknowledge that and we give him thanks. Last Sunday, when we were looking at that passage of scripture from 1 Kings chapter 8, I made mention of something. I said last Sunday that a heart that is fully committed to the Lord our God reveals itself in a life totally obedient God's boundaries, conditions, limits, and terms. Let me say that again. A heart that is fully committed to the Lord our God reveals itself in a life totally obedient to God's boundaries, conditions, limits, and terms. As it relates to human beings, it is true to say that boundaries, conditions, limits, and terms only exist in relationships. Only exist in relationships. Whether the relationships are work-related, or school-related, or marriage-related, or friendship-related. If there is no relationship, then there are no boundaries, and conditions, and limits, and terms. They don't exist in human-to-human interaction. The reason we are required to live a life that is totally obedient to God's boundaries, conditions, limits, and terms is because of the relationship that exists between God and us. If there is no relationship, then we don't have to adhere to any terms or conditions or anything. Do as we would when we want how we want, which is not the wise thing to do. However, relationships and the commitment they require must always be a two-way street. You don't have a relationship with yourself. Relationship is always, it always involves someone else. So, and I'm dealing here with human relationship, it always involves someone else, so it's always a two-way street. It's about you observing the boundaries, conditions, limits, and they observing some boundaries, conditions, and limits. So far, I have only spoken about the commitment God requires from us. I've only spoken about the fact that God expects us to observe His boundaries and limits and conditions. And sometimes when we look at the conditions and those limits that God has in place for us, they seem difficult. They seem insurmountable. They seem self-sacrificial. A lot of times we question ourselves and ask ourselves, well, do I want to enter into that kind of relationship? Because normally, a lot of times when people think of Christianity, they think of a religion that is underlined with a lot of rules, a lot of don'ts or can'ts. I can't do this and I can't do that and I can't do the next and I can't do the other. So a lot of times Christianity is viewed as in a very self-sacrificial way. Some of us who go under the label of Christians sometimes question ourselves. Should I really make that kind of commitment? The kind of commitment that God requires me to make? Where my life must be fully committed, my life must be totally obedient to God's boundaries and conditions and limits and terms? But church, the truth is this, God requires our full commitment because we have His full commitment. That's the only reason He requires it. Because as far as our relationship with God is concerned, this commitment is not a one-way thing. It's not God asking us to commit to Him and He's not committing to us. The season we are in, on the Christian calendar, is called Advent. This season reminds us of at least two of God's commitment to us. I just want to share with you this morning about one of those commitments that Advent reminds us of. The English word Advent derives from the Latin word Adventus, which means coming. All the word means is coming. As far as the Christian calendar is concerned, Advent speaks of two things. Advent speaks of a period of preparation for the celebration of the birth of Jesus Christ. And I think we all are familiar with that. But there's another thing that Advent speaks of. Advent also speaks of a period of preparation for the second coming of Jesus Christ. Traditionally, Advent is a period of 4 Sundays, or 4 weeks, like we would say, before Christmas. Those 4 weeks, traditionally, they are divided into 2 parts. The first 2 weeks places focus on the second coming of Christ, which is ironic. Because the first 2 weeks, you would want to think that it would follow in a natural pattern. So you would want to think that, well, you first focus on the birth of Christ and then leave the second coming. But that is not the tradition of Advent. The tradition of Advent, the first 2 weeks of the 4, they are focused on the second coming of Christ. And then the second 2 weeks, the focus is placed on the first coming of Christ, or the birth of Christ. Because you would realize that these 4 weeks would fall during December. And so the 25th of December, when we celebrate the birthday of Jesus Christ, would fall into the second 2 weeks. So that is the 2-week period traditionally, where the focus is on the birth of Christ. Having said that, from a traditional perspective, we are now in the period of Advent where the focus is on the second coming of Christ. And as we wrestle with the degree of the commitment that God requires from us, let us examine this commitment that God is calling us to make today. Let us examine that in the light of His commitment to us in His second coming. And for that, now I would like you to go to John's Gospel, chapter 14, verses 1 to 3. John's Gospel, chapter 14, verses 1 to 3. Can we? You don't have it running? Can we? We don't have it running. The King James Version of that says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, that where I am, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you would be also." The expanded version records those verses this way. Jesus said, "Don't let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God and trust in me. There are many rooms in my Father's house. I would not tell you this if it were not true. I am going there to prepare a place for you. After I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, so that you may be where I am." The subhead for that passage of scripture, I think it's from verses 1 to 14, falls under this subhead: Jesus comforts his followers. Jesus comforts his followers. This morning, Jesus' words of comfort comes home to all of us who are followers of Jesus Christ. And Jesus' words of comfort comes in a commitment to come back and to take us to be with him in a place that he has gone to prepare for us. That's the commitment that God gives us as we focus on his second coming. One writer puts those 3 in this way. He says, "If I go and prepare a place for you, you may be sure when everything is ready I will come again and receive you to myself, so that you shall follow me hereafter. That where I am, there you will be also. Isn't it comforting? Isn't it comforting to know that we don't just serve a Savior for the here and now? Isn't it comforting to know that we serve a Savior who is preparing a place for us? That in itself should be comforting news. But let's go a little further than that. We should have more comfort in the fact, not that he has gone to prepare a place for us, but that he will come again. He will come again to receive us and take us to the place that he has prepared. It's one thing to build a house. It's one thing to think about your dream house and to buy this dream piece of land and to speak to the architect and have him draw a plan for you and to be there while the contractor is working and see the foundation in place and see the walls go up and see all your dreams come to reality. And all that's good. Oh, church, but it's a different experience to live in the house. When the house, I mean, all the plastering is done, the electrical is done, the painting is done, and you can stand on the outside and say, oh, what a beautiful house. But church, the joy of the house is when you step inside. Hallelujah. Find God, prepare a place for you. You may be sure when everything is ready, I will come again. Being a follower of Jesus Christ this morning, it is comforting to know, firstly, that Jesus will come again. It's comforting to know that our Lord and our Savior will come again. When we were, and those of us who are adults, or when we were children, and our parents called us, said, Martin, come. One of the things they never like to hear is that I'm coming. I am sure that is true of most of your parents. They want to hear, they say, I'm coming, just come. When they say come, as far as they are concerned, in the next second you should appear in front of them. Don't call from somewhere they can't see and say, I'm coming. But that's what we do a lot of times. Even as children, we used to do that, say, I'm coming. Now, it might be that at the time they call, we might be indisposed. We might be doing something that we cannot immediately leave to go to them. But if that is the case, what we do is we start to hasten whatever we are doing to make preparation to go to them. Church, when Jesus says, I will come again, the Greek word that he uses, the translation, if you just take the Greek word out and translate it, it would not read, I will come again. It would read, I do come. Because it intimates the certainty of his coming. It doesn't read, I will come, or I may come. It reads, I do come. There's a certainty about God's coming. How we say it in the country, you can put your heart, your butt on the fire. He is coming. Question as to whether he is coming or will he come? Church, I mean, him coming is excellent. Oh, but the scripture gets personal. Scripture says he is coming to receive his faithful followers. He just coming, I'm sure. There's purpose in his coming. And the purpose is so that he will receive those, his followers, his faithful followers. Can I get a little more personal than that this morning? If you remain a faithful follower of Jesus Christ, then he's coming for you. Then he's coming for you. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 1, the verse there, what that verse does, it connects Jesus' second coming to our gathering together with him. You check the verse and verse. There's a homework. Check it out and see. It is as though it is making that into one event. We will be gathered together with him when he comes to us. Leon's leading in common justice this morning. I didn't tell you. Where else could you go? He's leading in common justice this morning. Remain faithful. Remain faithful. Not because he might come. Not because, well, there's a possibility that he might change that. Mm-hmm. He coming. For sure. He is coming. And not only he is coming for his people. There is comfort in knowing that. There is comfort in being a faithful follower. You know, one glad morning when this life is over. There's another thought. Being a follower of Jesus Christ, it is comforting to know that where Jesus is, there you will be yours. Hallelujah. Hey, church, listen. You know I'm always excited about walking the streets of hope. I'm excited about it. So, yes, he's coming for his faithful followers. But what he's coming to do with those faithful followers, he is coming to take those faithful followers with him. So that where he is, there we will be also. Church, I mean, you know, we have a very imaginative mind. You know, when we speak about where he will be, hallelujah. Church, listen, it's eternity we're speaking about. So he's not taking us with him for a time. He's taking us with him for 50 years or 100 years. We are going with him for eternity. Eternity. But there is a kind of thought that emanates from this written word when Jesus says that where I am, there you will be also. It seems as though Jesus' words there supports other scriptures like John 17, 24 and Philippians 1, 23 and 1 Thessalonians 4, 17. These verses declare that the ultimate height of heaven's happiness is being with Christ. Hallelujah! Church, listen, you know, I always talk about the streets of gold, but you know what the truth is? It is as if this verse is saying, look, even if you don't have streets of gold, it really doesn't matter. Once Jesus is there, that makes it all right. The writer of this song, I think it was Donnie McClurkin, who he penned the song and said, look, I'm not thinking about the sights. I'm not going to enjoy the view. I think heaven will be all right as long as you are there. As long as Jesus is there. Church, doesn't it excite you this morning that you want to be where Jesus is? That's the ultimate height of all happiness. There is nothing. A guy who used to live next to me always used to quote that there's nothing more pleasant in life than to pass on to others what one has learned for oneself. But church, there is nothing more pleasant than to know that we will spend eternity with Jesus. Church, I want to tell you something. When this verse speaks about that where he is, there we will be also. It's not only speaking about a location, you know. It's speaking about a state. Church, yes, we will be in the same location that Jesus is, but we will be as he is. We will not only be where he is, but we will be as he is, joint heirs with Christ. Hallelujah. We will not only be spectators of the glory of God, but we will share in the glory of Almighty God. One songwriter years ago penned the song. He said, "Lord, build me a cabin in the corner of glory land, in the shade of the old oak tree, that it may ever stand, so I can just hear the angels sing and I can shake Jesus' hand. Lord, build me a cabin in the corner of glory land." Church, the thought is this: my own cabin, man, my own place, man. I'm going to watch everybody else enjoying a mansion, and I have done. No, I'm there to share in the goodness and in the glory of Almighty God. That's what Jesus commits himself to doing for us when he comes again. When we read verses 1 to 3, when we read these verses over and over and over, about Jesus going to prepare a place for us, somehow we begin to get the idea that Jesus has no intentions for his preparations to be in vain. No. He will not build and furnish places and just let them stay empty. No, that's not his intention. You find it difficult to shake off the thought that God will complete the job. What? Why? How? Oh, church, somehow we get the impression that he has prepared a place for us and he will prepare us for that place. Just to prepare the place itself, it seems as though that, you know, that that's a complete job. God's commitment extends to preparing us for that place. And in due season, like the Bible says, in due time, he will not only prepare us, get us ready for that place, but he will put us in possession of it. Advent, therefore, shows us that God, through Jesus Christ, will fulfill his commitment to come back and to take us to be with him in that place that he has prepared for us. Should we then hesitate? Should we then question? Should we question whether we should live our lives totally obedient to the boundaries, conditions, limits, and terms of this God who will come again for us, this God who has gone to prepare a place for us, this God who has prepared a place for us, like he says, listen, where there is no pain, where there is no crying, where there is no death, where all church, where there are pleasures forevermore. This God who has gone to prepare us a place in paradise, are we ready? Should there be a question as to whether we should live our lives totally in obedience to this God? I want to close with some words of a song we used to sing as the Redeemed Messengers years ago. The song was written by one of the members of the Redeemed Messengers. The name of the song was "A Place Called Heaven." As God laid this on my heart, try as I may to remember the words of this song, couldn't remember it, but I remember the chorus of the song. The chorus of the song says, "A place called heaven, so beautiful, so rich in grace. A place called heaven. I know someday I will see that place. I'll see that place." That's the commitment that God has given to us. Advent reminds us that he will come again. He will come again to receive you unto himself. to the where he is, then you will be ours. If I ask you to tell me no, we won't have time. So don't tell me no. After service, we'll talk. But don't you think it is worth committing a life that is totally obedient to such a God? Don't you think? God will not settle for anything than the best for us, because he gives us, and I say gives us, present tense, his best. He gives us his best. Bow your head. Father God, who is like you? You're glorious in praises. You're doing wonders. You look beyond all faults. You continue to see our need. When we are down, you continue to lift us up. You, King of Kings, you, Lord of Lords, you, Commander in Chief, you, the God who created heaven and earth, you, the God who created us, you have committed yourself to come again and to receive us if we remain as long as we remain faithful. Oh God, we thank you for that commitment. We are reminded your word tells us you are not slack concerning your promises. Your yea is yea and your nay is nay. If your word says it, if you said it, that settles it, God. I ask this morning by the power of your Holy Spirit, Father God, let us always remember that commitment that you have made to us. Remind us of it, so that as we live day to day, as we walk, we will say, yes, I want to be ready. I want to be ready. I want to be ready to walk in Jerusalem just like you. Amen. And amen. Holy God. Have mercy on us, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. Blot out our transgressions, wash away our iniquity, and cleanse us from our sin. For we acknowledge our transgressions, and our sin is always before. Against you and you only have we sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So that you are proved right when you speak and justify when you judge, cleanse us with his son. And we shall be clean, wash us, and we shall be whiter than snow. Hide your face from our sins and blot out all our iniquity. Create in us a clean heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within us. Do not cast us from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from us, but restore to us the joy of your salvation and grant us a willing spirit to sustain us. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose nature it is to have mercy. Have mercy on us, God. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so that as we eat the emblems of your body, and as we drink the emblems of your blood, that we may evermore dwell in you, and you in us. Amen. And amen. If you truly and earnestly repent of your sins, and are in love and charity with your neighbors, and are resolved to lead a new life following the commandments of God, and walking henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith, and take this sacrament to your comfort and glory and grace. Come to this sacred table not because you must, but because you may. Come not to testify that you are righteous, but that you sincerely love our Lord Jesus Christ and desire to be his true disciples. Come not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Not because you have any claim on heaven's rewards, but because in your frailty and sin, you stand in constant need of heaven's mercy and help. Jesus said, come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, he said, and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest in your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never grow hungry, and he who believes in me will never be thirsty. Paul, writing to the Corinthians, he says, for I received from the Lord what I passed on. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until you. Those of you who are partaking of the Lord's Supper, please stand.
Beneath that blood, lose all.
The same manner after supper, he took the cup. He said, this cup is the new covenant, is the new agreement in my blood. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes. Drink one. Redeemed, oh, I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb.
Redeemed for His infinite mercy.
His child and forever I am. Say, I am redeemed.
everything will be all right. Everything will be fine. If you commit to God, God has already committed himself to you. You make up money for your gifts now. God, it is always a privilege, God, to receive from you. We thank you, God. We acknowledge, God, that all good gifts around us are sent from heaven above. And we thank you, God, that is you are the Jehovah Jireh, our provider, God, and you have blessed us. And because you have blessed us, we are able to share and we willingly come back to your house, God, as you in your word to bring back part of what you have blessed us with, and we give it willingly and ask God that you use us and use the gifts. You'll continue to be glorified. We pray, God, you continue to bless us and favor, and you'll continue to extend our borders, God, as we give, God, you'll continue to serve and supply. And as you give us, we shall give. We give you thanks in Jesus' name. It's good to have all of us here this morning. It's good to continue to be in God's house. Mr. Laurie, it's good to have you here with us. And your niece, go down there. Go down. With the mask, you can't make out everybody, you know. And that's your daughter. Good to have you all shared with us another time this morning. It's good to have Marcia, it's good to have you here with us. Stephon, good to have you and your sister. Good to have all. Jacob, it's really good to see you. I know. Jacob, it's good to see you. Really, really good to see you. We are glad that for the Friday, you know, for the Friday last week, we have prayed for the Friday, for the Friday and round. And we knew that God was always going to be with him. We knew God was always with him. For the Friday, it's really, really good. You were missed. And all of the Wednesdays and Saturday morning, yesterday morning, again, prayed for you and we miss you really. We see you know how much you are loved and appreciated here. For company is not the same as Brother Friday and Brother James. But for now, we are concentrating on Brother Friday. We need a bit of that. We continue to pray as well as Brother Alicia spoke about the Father. Continue to pray for the doctors that we out of hospital soon. Continue to pray with Sister Christine. We come along. We give God thanks. Sister Marva. We give God thanks. Sister Diane Ross. Continue to pray Sister Diane Ross. Yeah. Continue to pray Sister Phoenix. Sister Auntie William. Sister June. Sister June and George. Sister June Waterman. Continue to lift up these places in prayer. You know, we pray for this on a Saturday morning, but we ask it during the week. When you remember our brother and sister, we never be prayer. And God's strength will continue to be with them. We thank God for those who are recovering and those who are recovered. You know, Sister Sharon, we're very good to have you here with us this morning. We thank all of you who we have this cycle. Even if you are here every Sunday, we are glad that you are here this Sunday. We do not take it for granted. This is the last of the first Sunday. This is the first of the last Sunday of 2020, and we give God thanks. We really do love it. Sister Regina, it's always a pleasure to just look at you. All the time, just look at you. Is that fine? It is the end of the year, December, and we are going to have our Christmas morning service at 4 o'clock. COVID can't take a minute. All right, very good. So let me listen. And think about it. When I said before, I wanted to see how many people would have appealed to the poor. I told you, I'm going to stay silent and then I'm going to ask her and see whether we can leave that poor. So it is very fine. It is fine. But thank you, sister. So, sir, I can raise the banner very high. So, five years. But at one time, there was one thing that I called on. I remember the very first came up here, there was a professor here, this me. And then the strange thing about it, when you said this was at 4, all of you would look in the church. But of course, you know, not that people, they get up early in the morning, and they look for somebody to go to the competition for a professor, and they're not true. So I said, they just love to be in the house of God. You know, they were looking forward to that, but now it is 5 a.m. And is it Friday or Friday?
Yeah.
Friday, 25th, we will meet in here at 5 a.m. Holiest night, of course, we continue. This is one of the pastor, and he was asking me, how long do we go with services? And so we go at 90 minutes. He said, He said, but I'm not sure, say, but you know what I mean, with the government, and this and that. And you know, they want to make it in that political. And I said, and you know, he told me, he said, you know what? 90 minutes is 90 minutes. He said, I can go on the land. I said, that is it. You go with 90 minutes because that is the law of the land. You have to be obedient. And when you stand as a church, say that you flouted, and according to him, he said, he don't care about Rory. You can't be a Christian leading a congregation and say you don't care about the Prime Minister. Really? Then you are telling your members, disregard what the government says. And we should not try to bring in that into the equation. So, Holiest Night will be at 10:30, because again, 10:30 to 12 is 90 minutes. So we need, instead of 10, which we usually meet at 10, we're going to meet at 10:30, we'll meet at 10:30. Because of course, when 12 o'clock reaches, when 12 o'clock reaches at the services, and of course we wouldn't be walking up and down, so we're going to go beyond, so we don't want to go 10, and then we're going to cut it to 11:30. So 10:30, and we will have our normal Holiest Night service. We continue to have all our services every Wednesday. Two more services Wednesday until we're going to close. Maybe a couple of weeks until the new year. So we're going to have Wednesday night, Bible study, the 9th, which is this Wednesday, and the 16th. We have 2 more weeks to discuss matters that we have been talking about on Wednesday. So we meet Wednesday evening at the 9th day at 6 o'clock. And again, the following Wednesday, next week, Wednesday at the 16th, we're going to meet again. Men Fellowship, many of us are going to be meeting on Thursday here, many are going to meet, which is the 10th. And after Thursday, I guess after the night meeting, you will decide. You will decide where it goes from there. And men, as we saw that on this Thursday, men, those of you who are interested in Susu 2021 and whatever, that discussion is up on Thursday of this week. So please. Not the SS. Men who say that's Susu, not the SS. Not the SS at all. We don't have that cover, we open for scrutiny. Birthdays. Do we have birthdays between now and? And one birthday today, my cousin Debbie birthdays today. Tuesday? Okay. That is the 9th, set this 8th. The 8th, okay, Tuesday's proceedings are, but Debbie birthdays today. Who's going to happy birthday? I'm going to come back to church and say happy birthday. It's true, they don't have a message here. I mean, they have been yesterday. But I know they've been on. Can we still see her on? Right. And anybody else? Wednesday or the mission? Wednesday? And Simon, where's on Tuesday? Simon, you came up for my video. How about the anniversary when it was in yours and you tried to kill? So Wednesday night. Alright. So we have birthdays, then birthdays, the 6th. We have Christy and what was this? 8th, we have anniversary. So on behalf of what we want to say, we really want to extend to brother, sister Macmillan, brother Simon, sister Patrick Macmillan, a lot of precious blessings. We thank God for your important part of us. You know how much we love our ministry. And I ask that clapping long time. Really love and appreciate you sharing in the ministries, and you know, for your anniversary, ask God's richest blessing as He has blessed you all. We know He has blessed you all. You all have been a good example to marriage, and we pray that for the next year and the years ahead, God will continue to surround you with good kind of strength, blessings, and favor. Right? And so, Carolyn, somebody to chat with, and then somebody to write your number of people that can chat with and talk about going forward. Thank you, Carolyn. And go there, just and go there, and go there, now. And okay, so let's go. Thank you. not be extended on behalf of me.
Best wishes to her.
Yes, all of us. Bless her. And all of her. And so I heard Sister Lucy also know that we now appreciate and give the best wishes of the church for a wonderful day on Wednesday, Tuesday. And God's wishes, blessing for her, and all God's blessings we have for her. Can you stand? And again, Simon and Nancy, we really want to bring God's wishes blessing upon you. Brother Hill, those are a few others that have said, so those of you who are not seeing from either Praise and Worship or who are frontier, they did ask for excuse today. And as we pray for ourselves, we continue to pray for those who are absent, pray for the sick, the shut in, as we continue to give God thanks to all those around. Father, we thank you that we could have met in your presence. We thank you, God, that you are a God who cares for us, and that care is extended to us whilst we are here collectively and individually. And so, God, when we leave this place now and we go back to our home, face different situations, go back to school, to work, to the environment, wherever we go, we know, God, although we will be sometimes by ourselves, we are not alone because you are present with us. You care for us and you promise not to leave us nor forsake us. We pray, oh God, that you will give us strength. Lord, I'm going to hear that word this morning. Give us strength so that word we can commit ourselves totally to you. We can allow ourselves, Lord, to be committed so that place that you have gone to prepare, we will be there with you. We say thank you, Lord, and we thank you and we appreciate, God. It is not just a place, God, but it's a state, God, where we will be, how we will be. We say thank you, God, for the word that came and how it came to us, we receive it. We pray, God, for the week ahead, we will continue to be victorious, knowing that you are victor, and Lord, you go before us. Now, with the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest, remain, abide us all, now and forever. Amen and amen. Have a blessed week. Invite somebody to come to church next week. We thank God for all of you who are here. We pray safety and a wonderful week. Continue to be blessed. In Jesus' name.